First of all, let me tell you about, give you a general overview of what we do online. So here's a picture collage, CEO, Google, YouTube, a lot of things I'm sure you guys already know. But what I want to bring out here is that there has been a gradual shift from more larger and bulkier social media sites like Facebook and blogs to quicker and more easier platforms such as WhatsApp and Snapchat right now. So I'm not sure how many of you know this, but there has been a rapid decline in the number of young people like us using or at least being active on Facebook. We still have our Facebook accounts, we can't really delete them. But there is a decline in the number of people that are actively looking at the content on Facebook and posting up on Facebook. Instead, what we see now is a lot of Snapchat and WhatsApp users. Now, so why do we use these platforms? Why is it so popular? Well, one of the key reasons is for their quick and easy communication. Now, I'm sure many of you should know, life of a student is pretty difficult these days, alright? We have our school to juggle, obviously, and then we have our CCAs, normally lasting us until 4 to 5 p.m. For primary school, perhaps a bit earlier. And then after that, we have to go back home and do our homework. Even during our weekends, we will work on our projects. During holidays, you have to go back to school, we have to work on our homework. You know, being a student is really a 24-hour job, right? So, what happens is that sometimes our social life will really get neglected. We don't really have time to talk to our friends. We talk in class, we get scolded by our teacher. So where else do we talk? We talk on these platforms. So on the go, on the MRT, you know, we can talk. Really, we can really connect with our friends these days. Instead of having to gather them together and meet face-to-face, which is really difficult because everyone's schedules are, you know, so different, we can use these platforms. And that is why you see a lot of young people these days always on their phones texting, because we don't have really any other time to do it. So the key thing is, like, as students, we understand that, you know, it's important that we, you know, communicate face-to-face, but sometimes we really get caught up, get swept away by this super fast-paced world that we don't know when to put down our phone. And so that is the key reason why there's so much concern over the addiction to these platforms here. And another thing I want to talk about is the use of these platforms for collaboration. Now, I myself use these platforms a lot during my project work because, you know, when you have a 4-people group and then you need to communicate with them, and half of them is in CCA, the other half is at home, and one more other guy is in school, then it's really difficult to come together and work together. So using these platforms and using other platforms like Skype or Google Hangouts, we can continue to work even though we are not together. So this is a way that we use technology for education. So how else do we use technology for education? Well, Google is a, you know, big search engine. It is a very large treasure trove of information, and they say information is power. So with so much information at our fingertips, we feel empowered by this availability of information. Whenever we don't know something, we can search it out immediately. And so this gives us a lot of power and a lot of possibilities where we can almost feel like we can do whatever we want, right? And also, there are a lot of online news sites like Today that give us a lot of information about the current ongoings of the world. And also, social media sites also give us a lot of news. So, other than that, we also use, other than for work, we also use our devices for entertainment, like Spotify. How many of you here have heard of Spotify? It's the logo on your left. No one? Wow, that is amazing. Let me tell you more about that then. It's currently quite popular among the secondary school JC students scene. It's an online music streaming app. It allows you to listen to music online, basically. Basically, it's modern radio. But now, instead of having to wait for your particular radio DJ to play a certain song, or, you know, maybe you can like pick some songs, you can go to Spotify and you can listen to whatever genre you want, and even to a certain extent, what the specific songs that you want. And why these why Spotify and to a certain extent YouTube is so popular is that we can do this on demand whenever we want. You know, gone are the days where we have to wait for 7 p.m. to wait for a favorite show to come on. You know, we can watch it anytime now, and we can go back and you know, watch the shows that we missed. And also, so Spotify and YouTube are examples of social media as well. We can see what our friends like. We can see what our friends are watching and listening online. And you know, wouldn't you too want to know what your friends are doing? And then, because your friends like it, wouldn't you be curious to take a look at it yourself? And so, a lot of us will go online, check out what our friends are doing, and then use this as like conversation starters. You know, when use this as a way to connect with our friends, to talk to our friends, even when there's like nothing to talk about. So let me give you a few examples of what we do on YouTube today. And when I brought this up to some of the people I know in MDA, they were generally surprised because like they don't know that this exists. So one very popular thing, and it's pretty weird, is Let's Play videos on YouTube. How many of you have heard of Let's Play videos? Okay, I see a few hands, that's good. Let's Play videos are basically videos of people playing games. So basically, you watch other people play games. Some of you might think this is weird, but what you watch it for is for the live commentary. It's like watching soccer. You can't actually play soccer, but you can hear the commentary and you can see the action. So it's something like this. It really gets your blood pumping, and you really see, like, you get to experience the game even without having to own the game. And other things are like, you know, I'm sure most of you should know Minecraft is very popular right about now, although it's dying, starting to die off. And then there are versus videos where you get to see people compete against each other in playing games. And last of all, I would like to tell you more about this whole concept of stardom. You know, back, I think it was like 3 or 5 years ago, we had the whole 1 minute of fame thing on TV. Now you don't have to go on TV to be famous. You can be famous right in your own room through Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, etc., etc. And I know it was mentioned earlier on that, you know, us youths really like to post whatever they do, what we wear, when we're sleeping, what we're eating. And I guess to a certain extent this is true, but what we are trying to do really is to build up an online identity for ourselves. What we are trying to do is portray ourselves in a way that will seem cool, will attract the attention of our friends and other people in our social circle, so that it will matter in other people's lives. What I see a lot online is people post up when they do badly in their O-levels, they post up, then you see a lot of their friends consoling them, you know, telling them, giving them advice. Then you see people posting that they got good results, then you get to share the happiness, share the joy. We can really impact other people's lives through these social media sites. And we can be a part of someone else's life. We can know what our friends are doing, and we can, to a certain extent, influence what they are doing. And so this gives us a lot of more power and a lot of, attention to ourselves. I'm not saying that we are trying to like seek attention, we are overly attention-seeking, but really gives, like, who wouldn't want to be famous, you know? So these platforms really give us a chance to be pseudo-famous. So here are some things I learned back in school about cyber wellness. Most of this was part of either my school's or MOE cyber wellness programs. Viruses, how not to click suspicious links, how I'm not always the 1 million visitor to a website. So these things, you know, we learn a lot about inappropriate material, pornography, what's good, what's bad, piracy as well. Credibility of information, how Wikipedia is not always credible, and what to post and what not to post online. So the reason why I want to bring this up is that these topics are still very big on a lot of cyber wellness frameworks here. A lot of parents still constantly, you know, tell their children that to be careful of these things. But I think to a certain extent, us youths are getting tired of listening to this. We get irritated when it is a constant reminder, hey, please don't do this, please don't do this. Okay, yes, I get it. Right? So these are what I would say the facts that we know. And repeated reinforcement probably isn't going to help. Periodic reinforcement is important so that we don't forget them. But if you are telling us about this, you know, every other day, every other week, it gets tiring. And instead of listening to you, your children are going to shut off from you and they are going to completely ignore you. So that's the danger here. Now, let me tell you some observations I've had of the online world these days. Cyberbullying is a very issue that's an issue that's very close to my heart because I've experienced this for myself back in secondary one when I just got into my school. One of my friends who was a little bit on the obese side, you know, as kind of expected, he got made fun of by his friends. So it gradually devolved into cyberbullying where on Facebook, which was still quite popular at the time, and WhatsApp, a lot of people post derogatory remarks about him, you know, make fun of him, and it didn't look like it at first. Whenever teachers would ask him, like, are you okay with them doing this, he would say that he's okay. But as a close friend of his, eventually he would come and confide with me and say that, you know, I don't really like it when they do that and I wish they would stop. Now the problem is, when I approached the few people that were making fun of him, they didn't think he was that badly affected by it. They thought that, you know, it was fun and he accepted it because normally he would laugh together with them. So they thought that they weren't doing any major damage, but they were. So there's a lot of these cases of silent victims and unwitting cyberbullies. Victims that don't really want to come out and say that they're being bullied because it's slightly embarrassing and they kind of draw up a lot of attention to themselves. And also these cyberbullies who don't know that they are cyberbullied, and that is very scary because it's sort of like having criminals that don't know that they're doing something wrong. So with all these problems, it further complicates things that there are cases where parents overreact to cyberbullying, where the kid is really having fun with their friends, you know, it's just some playful banter, some just chatting. Then the parent comes in and completely overreacts and says, why are you cyberbullying my child? I'm going to report this to your principal. And then that kind of turns back and bites your child from behind, you know, I've seen cases where it has turned into cyberbullying, where their friends make fun of him for having such kiasu parents and attracting the entire attention of the school. So we really have to be very careful when we approach cyberbullying. Another thing is multitasking. I know that multitasking is very frowned upon right now, but I want to say that there are people out there that can multitask effectively. I am one of those people to a certain extent. Right? But at the same time, there are people who cannot multitask and pretend to be able to multitask. So what is important then is that you communicate with your child. Alright, and I think the other speakers will touch more on this whole concept of how to talk to your child later on. Another thing is distractions. And you know, when your child is always on their mobile device and keep staring at it, like some parents think that, you know, they're gaming, they're distracted, they're not doing their work when they should be. But sometimes, as I've mentioned earlier, we are using these devices for our benefit, for collaboration, for communication. And so sometimes when they are in the middle of a discussion for their project and tell them to keep their phone, it really impacts them, and that's why they get so angry, because you are literally disturbing them while they are working. Right? So it's important to know what your child is doing, whether or not by looking over their shoulder, which might not exactly be a good thing, or through other means which the other speaker will share about again. And another thing is the digital footprints. Now, as students, we hear a lot about digital footprints from our cyber awareness lessons. We know that we have to be careful about what we do online, be careful about what we post, be careful about the pictures and videos we post online, because it is all recorded, it's all permanent. But have you considered what you have been posting online about your child? Now, I know of some parents that when they just give birth to their children, they post pictures, baby pictures of their children online. Think about 10 years later when their child grows up and see their baby pictures online and like, that's pretty embarrassing. What about, you know, when you have family gatherings like Chinese New Year or parties, then you go ahead and post up a video of your child doing something funny or stupid and all their friends see it. You know, we know that we are leaving behind a very large digital footprint, but we will also appreciate it if the people around us are aware of the digital footprint they are leaving behind, which will eventually come back and affect us. So one very easy way to do this is just to ask your children, can I post this? Will you be okay with me posting this? Right? So what to expect as your children grow older? Yeah, I think most of you here are parents of primary and secondary school children, right? Now that I'm in JC, perhaps I can give you a bit of insight as to what might change. So from primary school to secondary school, I would like to believe that primary school children are a lot easier to teach and educate. They are a lot more receptive when their parents come and tell them, you don't do this because you blah, 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 blah. But when they go on to secondary school, a lot of secondary school students tend to shut out their parents. And one big thing, one main reason for this is privacy. We value our privacy and we want that to be treated as human beings that deserve our privacy. So then this brings up the issue of trust, whether or not you can trust your children and whether we can trust you. If you don't trust us, we can't trust you. And so, what do we do? What happens? So I think it's important that when your children are in primary school, it's important to teach them the right values, and then when they move on, it will be a lot easier to correct them if they do something wrong. Now, from secondary school to JC, it's a lot less of a steep change because a lot of the things that we do in secondary school is the same as the things you do in JC. However, we do see a lot more use of technology in education. Now, even in my school, we use Google Docs for collaboration, which is a tool that allows multiple people to edit the same Word document at once, do presentations together, we can create cool infographics together. So when you have to be careful, because if you disturb them while they are in the middle of a project where the deadline is tomorrow, then I believe they have the right to be angry at you, really. So they are going to be using their devices for work a lot more, but also they are going to have a lot less time as well. So I hope that you'll be able to give them a bit more room to be able to chat with their friends and to be able to maintain their social circle. Right. So I hope that this gave you a bit of insight as to what your children are thinking about and how they are feeling when you react to certain actions of theirs. Thank you very much.